friends, a lot from you. I've seen many topics, and my talk is going to be less technical. Try to keep it simple. And if you have any questions, let me know. I will try to address them immediately. And I'll try to speak loud. Can you hear me at the back?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you so much. Fantastic. So I'll talk about robust perception. Perception today is mostly done by machine learning, deep learning, and I think machine learning and broadly robotics is on many people's minds, researchers' minds, also investors' minds, also journalists. And today you can read all kinds of news articles, kind of scary stories about robots. A machine may not take your job, but one could become your boss. White collar robots are coming for jobs. Robots will destroy our jobs, and we're not ready for it. So you see all those scary stories, and I hope you don't believe them too much. Okay. So maybe some of you know about this Gartner hype curve. So it shows you how new technologies are absorbed, are accommodated in the society. And initially, there's a lot of interest, a lot of hope when something is introduced. Think of 5G. And then maybe the first accidents happen, the first crashes happen, the first issues happen. And then people become a bit disappointed. And if companies are persistent and pursue the technology, it will eventually reach the market. Now guess where deep learning is? Deep learning is at the peak. Oops, sorry. Here's deep learning. Right at the peak. And autonomous vehicles already crossed the peak. Why? Well, people have been waking up. There have been accidents. There was one in Singapore, small accident with autonomous vehicles. So I think we're beyond the peak of autonomous vehicles, as in the hype peak of autonomous vehicles. Of course, the hype is there for good reason. Deep learning has been quite successful. I'm showing here results for a well-known competition. It's to detect objects and images, specifically in the ImageNet database. So we have many different types of images. When the competition started in 2011, the error rate was quite high, still 25%. And then gradually it has been decreasing over time, and now it's 5%. Even less, the data is 2017, point today is maybe 2 or even less percentage. So you may think, well, computer vision has been solved, it's fantastic results, so maybe we should move on to a different research area. Computer vision has been solved by deep learning, you may think. Well, I'm showing you here soon that it's not the case at all. So what do we work on in our team? We figure out, when does deep learning fail? How can we fix it? And what does it mean for autonomous vehicles? So what if perception systems are not perfect? They do fail sometimes. What's the impact of that on autonomous vehicles? That's the second part of my talk. I'll talk about real-life perception systems and how they have impact on the driving behavior of autonomous vehicles. Okay. The first part. So what do you see on the left? What do you see on the right? Of course, panda. Now what does Google Net, very fancy object detector, detect? Google Net, detects panda on the left with about 60% confidence. That's very confident. This is actually a given. Very confident. This is a given. If you don't know what a given is, I don't know how to look it up. Here it's how it looks like. Okay, so very different, also very cute, but quite different, right? So what happened there? Well, some very smart people tried to trick the Google Net detector. They added a noise detector, which we don't perceive, we don't see it, but it's strong enough and confusing enough for the detector to label this as a gibbon, not as a panda. So even though it's not perceivable, the machine is confused. So clearly, deep learning is fragile, and there's a gap between machine perception and human perception. This has been found in 2014 and 2013. So this is so-called adversarial attack, well-known attack, and that was, I would say, one of the first cases where people became cautious and concerned about deep learning, one of the first cases. Now, when I saw that, I wasn't very afraid of that, because how likely is this to happen in nature? If you drive on the road, you won't have such noise factor optimized naturally, I would guess. So maybe it doesn't really make a big difference, doesn't really matter that much. However, then we did some experiments. So we had a dash cam with pictures in Singapore, and it was raining. So we have we have raindrops. You can see raindrops on the windshield, and some of them are labeled as cars. So we took a fast RCNN, state-of-the-art detector, and labeled some of the raindrops as cars. That's, I think, quite disturbing, right? If this were an EV, you drive around and you'd see cars, but there are no cars, maybe it would brake, you'd try to avoid them, but there are no cars, so it would be very confusing and very dangerous, potentially. That's something that, you know, is disturbing in the lead. Okay, so of course, yes?
Just a quick question. Is that fast RCNN fine-tuned on like a driving data set, or is it just something trained on ImageNet?
They're just out-of-the-box ImageNet, so this is not optimized for this kind of images. You just took standard ImageNet, standard fast RCNN, and applied to that data. So, of course, autonomous cars have many sensors, cameras, also LiDARs and radars, and typically the AV has a combination of such different sensors. But some companies would like to get rid of LiDAR and radar, just want to rely on cameras. So from the previous example, maybe that's concerning. If you only rely on a camera, you may lead to wrong detections and wrong decisions. So LiDARs provide, as you probably know, high-density, high-quality 3D maps. But yeah, some companies only want to rely on cameras because LiDARs are quite expensive. So from a commercial viewpoint, it's much more attractive to rely only on cameras. We did more experiments. So we applied inception to images of cars. So this is a moving van, it was correctly labeled. Maybe then rotated the images, we just rotate them at a small angle, 10 degrees, and less. Then the labels become very confusing. Snowplow, monitor, car mirror, school bus. Completely confused. We took the image, we just rotated it. Plus 10, plus 15, plus 20, minus 10, minus 15. Can you tell me why this happened? How come so brittle? I just rotated the image. This is not fake, yeah? This is real. What happened? How come inception is so sensitive? What went wrong in the whole process?
And some examples of.
Examples. So inception is trained on ImageNet, the same ImageNet on my second slide. And my students took time to look at ImageNet, took out the examples of cars, and then he made a histogram, so he calculated the angles. Made a histogram of the angles, and indeed, most cars are nicely straight, vertical, not tilted. And so basically, the inception detector has never seen rotated cars before. They're very unlikely to happen in a data set. Yeah, that's why it has never seen tilted cars, so it won't detect them. And that's, of course, a major issue. If the training set is not comprehensive, the system will be brittle, but not detect what it should be detecting. That was a clear issue. So maybe you can offer a solution. How can we fix this?
Better data sets.
Yes, of course. How?
Improving data sets with rotated cars.
Exactly. So, yes?
I was saying that you could also use something like an image data generator where you would flip existing images either sideways or rotate.
It's the same idea. So you take the, you basically augment your data sets. You take the images, you rotate them, clip them, scale them, whatever. Issue is, now your data set is much bigger, maybe 10 times bigger, it will take 10 times more time to train a system, potentially. Not so good. But the idea is, right? So you can take an image, turn this fat image, and then you can rotate it, you clip it, have some occlusion, and you feed that into the network, and you train it. Okay? Cumbersome, because you have to create this data set, it will take more time to train, and the question is fundamentally, is the system smarter now? Is it smarter? Has it learned anything extra? So if it looks at these images, for the system these are all cats. So always say cat, 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 cat. Of course, they're all different pictures, right? At different angles, and then in some cases, the head is not there. But the system doesn't know, it just says for all those pictures are cats for the system. So I would say it hasn't learned anything extra. So what is an alternative? disentangle representation. So we have in the system actual variables which encode transformations, such as rotations and also scaling. So when you sample from the system, from the network, it will automatically rotate digits and scale them and do all kinds of transformations. So in the system itself, you have those variables. When it sees a cat, it'll take an angle, it will tell, okay, it's a cat with 15 degrees. This can actually tell you more than just, okay, it's a cat. It'll tell you about the scaling, maybe about skew. So that's the idea. But it tells you more than just a label. It tells also something about the transformations that the image underwent in the creation of the image. Right? That's the idea. So we have, in a system, physical variables describing what happened in the scene. Yep. Yes, questions?
So is that equivalent to just saying you're normalizing the images and keeping the normalization data as another attributes?
Maybe it's equivalent, but it's not really like that. It's part of the generation process. So we train the system through GAN. And in the generation process, we actually have transformations happening there. So we don't actually normalize the image itself. We infer from the image the transformation variables. In addition to the labels. Okay? So you find out it's a particular angle, the scaling factors are learned from the image itself. So what transformations are we looking into? Skew, zoom, rotation, which combined together leads to affine transformations. So you encode those in the neural network. So if you think about it more abstractly, so I've actually come from this field of statistical signal processing, where we develop models, for instance, to build radar systems. If you build a radar system, you are in control. You can design the pulses, the pulse length, the shape of the pulse, and so forth. The physics also are well known, Maxwell equations. So the model is really well known. Maybe it's very ugly, in many terms, it's complicated, but you can write down the model. There are many parameters, but you can actually describe them. They have physical meaning, width, height of the pulse, and so forth. That's one field. Kind of white box. We have nice models of everything. It's physics oriented, physics based. The other extreme, if you will, is machine learning, where you have also a model, but it's kind of black box. You have parameters, which are weights, but if you have, say, 10 million weights, it's hard to tell what the meaning is of the 57th weight. Whatever weight, it's hard to explain the meaning of each weight. So these are just kind of fitting parameters. So in a sense, you have like white box modeling and black box modeling. So what we argue is that if you bring those together, you can build more robust machine learning systems. So it's good to have extra physical variables in the machine learning system. That's the idea. So here's the idea. So you have like a purple model. Before you had blue and red. Blue was white box, and red was black box. You can have a purple model where some parts are totally flexible, or weights. Some parts have physical meaning. Okay, so you can bring those together into one model. You may have physical variables. I talked about affine transformations, and you may have also weights. And these weights may describe the handwriting, how people write digits. But the parameters describe the scaling and so forth, rotations of the digits themselves. Okay, so you have a mix of parameters which have physical meaning and then weights. And the model has flexible unknown parts and known parts. So in this way we can generate digits. And this is themselves, the handwriting comes from the neural network, and then the rotations, the scaling and support come from the physical parameters. How do we train the neural networks? Well, the basic idea is coming from the generative adversarial network. How many of you know about GANs? It's such a hot topic in machine learning, of course. So some of you, not many of you. Let me try to explain this. So you have basically competition between a counterfeiter and a police officer. A counterfeiter tries to create fake money. Works very hard to look at actual money and makes fake money that looks very similar. Okay? The police officer tries to distinguish real from fake money. Over time, they get better and better. police officer looked at particular features in the banknotes to tell the difference between fake and what's true, true money, actual money. The generator, the counterfeiter, looks at the banknotes carefully and gets better and better at copying and creating fake banknotes. So that's a competition between those two. Okay. Now, internally, this counterfeiter has a model of how banknotes look like. So it's like a model. Internally, he has a model, he or she has a model of banknotes. So how does it now relate to neural networks? Well, the counterfeiter is a so-called generator. And the police officer is a discriminator. It tells the difference between fake and true actual data. So both are neural networks. The generator learns how to create fake images from random noise, can be Gaussian noise. So this is a complex nonlinear system, which by training will learn how to convert random noise image into a fake image which looks like a digit. Okay? By training. The discriminator receives a fake image and a real image, and has to tell the difference, has to tell which one is fake, which one is real. Okay? And they optimized through this min-max game, which is a zero-sum game. They compete against each other. And so as the meaning of here, the function D, the meaning function, if that is close, so if that's, if D is close to 1, then this function would be the largest, would be maximized. Okay. So the discriminator will try to maximize this function. It's like the success rate of the discriminator, and the generator will try to actually confuse the discriminator, will try to minimize this function. Okay, and min-max. Min-max, minimum with regard to generator, maximum with regard to discriminator. Okay. So, again, if D is successful, then it will output 1 or close to 1 when it's a real image and 0 otherwise. So that's why you have a real image here. Log of 1 would be close to 0. If it's wrong, it would be log of 0, it would be minus infinity, very, very low number. Okay. So it's successful if D is close to 1, if it's a real image. So here you have them 0 or a fake image. That's how it works. So you have a zero-sum game. The two compete. If it converges, then, that's the whole point, the generator will be able to create fake images which look like real images. That's kind of the magic. You give it noise, it's able to create two images on the floor. Okay. Think of images of rooms, different spaces. So it would create images of rooms that don't even exist, but they look like rooms. Okay. Any questions so far? This is GAN. If you have any questions about GAN, this is a very hot topic in machine learning, a very revolutionary idea. It was proposed in 2014 by Ian Goodfellow at Stanford University. And at the beginning, it was actually very hard to make this converge. There's a complex optimization. Now there's a whole community of people trying to make this really practical and applicable to many different domains. Okay, so in a nutshell, what do we do? Well, in this generation process, we also apply affine transformations. And so that's how we can kind of infuse physical variables in this system, in this neural network. System neural networks, and that's how we can disentangle transformations from the classes, the different digits. So we add here an extra term which is about mutual information for learning the affine transformation matrix. I won't talk about that in detail. I will now show some results to motivate why this is useful, actually. So if you I show results for a vanilla CNN, convolutional neural network, where we feed in missed digits that are rotated. So you can see at the zero angle, it's very successful. It has a very high accuracy of close to 99%. As you rotate the images, the digits, the performance drops to 83%. So 30 degrees plus 30 minus 30. So you see that the vanilla CNN is very sensitive to the angle. Now, if you want to do this, you could add adversarial examples. Not a good the idea, but you can try. It doesn't help, actually it hurts. However, if you add, if you include rotated images, as some of you suggested, then it becomes robust. Yeah? So because it has seen tilted objects, now it's able to have high accuracy even for tilted images, as what you'd expect. Now, for the proposed approach, the same happens, so it's also robust. Now, it has slightly lower accuracy because our system is totally unsupervised. We don't have labels, we don't use labels, so it's an unsupervised approach, whereas the other approaches are supervised. So again, it's robust under different angles, and there's a small loss in the performance because it's unsupervised. We don't provide labels, so it's able to learn to separate different digits.
Could you clarify how you train the classifier once you have your GAN generator? So you have your generator, it's generating some images that have affine transformations on them. How do you then train the classifier without labels?
So it has hidden variables, they stand for the class. So one hidden variable in the system encodes the class label. Okay. So it's actually InfoGAN, it's a bidirectional InfoGAN, to which you add affine transformations. I won't discuss that in detail. I would like to show more stuff, but I can bring it up later after the talk with Q&A. Okay. But I can move on and show more results. So, that's for rotated images. Now we look at the serial attacks as well. So this is a full slide of the graph. So let's look at the following. So what we do is we apply the serial attacks to the network and to the CNN, the vanilla CNN. Without attacks, it has high accuracy, as I mentioned, 99%. After applying attacks, the accuracy drops drastically to 30%, even 0% for the EGD attack. If you add rotated images, of course, it doesn't help against the serial attacks, so you have the same performance, actually a bit worse. If you add adversarial examples, it becomes more robust against the serial attacks, not surprising. Now, our system, at its GAN, is very robust against the serial attacks, which it is not optimized to handle the serial attacks, yet it becomes robust against them. Probably because it's encoding rotations, so it's probably hard to design attacks that are robust against rotations. So, because the system knows about physical transformations, it's able to overcome adversarial attacks. So you can see that actually it's very robust against adversarial attacks compared to CNN, and even the case where you augment the data with adversarial examples. So that's quite a nice kind of side effect by incorporating physical transformations to the system. It's able to overcome adversarial attacks.
Can you say again what an adversarial attack is?
Yes, so I'll show you. Do you remember the panda example? So where you...
Okay.
Yeah, so you optimize the noise factor. Mm-hmm. So this is an adversarial attack. So you optimize the noise factor to confuse the attacker. So it messes up the label. Now, the thing is that our system has internal rotations and scaling and so on, so it's probably hard to design such a noise vector that's robust against rotations, that's invariant to rotations. I think that's the intuition. I haven't done analysis, but if you incorporate physical transformation to the system, it's much harder to read the system with such simple, naive noise vectors.
Are you saying that you trained it without adversarial
correct
data and it was robust because of the physical?
That's true. That's the whole point. We didn't add any. In fact, it's better than adding adversarial examples, which is very interesting. Then go back. So here's a case where you add adversarial examples in the database in your train sets. And without such examples, AdaScan outperforms those three cases. So by having physical transformations into the system, it's able to overcome adversarial attacks. Okay, so in summary, that's the first part of my talk. So deep learning is more sensitive to all kinds of transformations, adversarial attacks. People are working on making the systems more robust by incorporating physical information, physical variables into the system that describe the physical world. And I think that's a pathway to make deep learning systems more robust. It's kind of a marriage between graphical models, where you incorporate prime information about the system, and on the other hand, deep learning systems, which are more or less black box. That's kind of, in a nutshell, the agenda we have. I'm happy to make interpreting prior information and physical variables. So, okay, so perception systems will improve over time. They will become more robust, for sure. And people like us and other people in the world are trying to make them more and more robust. But of course, perception will never be perfect. If you build an AV, you'll have to somehow model mislabelings of the perception system, or maybe misdetections, or offsets in the bounding boxes. So you have to somehow incorporate all that in your system design. And what we work on is we work on simulations of AVs which incorporate perception errors. Okay, so what's the context of this? Well, at LinTU we have the Center of Excellence for testing and research of autonomous vehicles, and we have a test track, which I'll show in a minute. And it's a partnership between NTU, our university, LTA, the Land Transport Authority, and several companies. We try to do research towards testing procedures for autonomous vehicles. Okay. And so we have a small test track, often compared to test tracks in Michigan, also in California. I think they have much bigger test tracks, but Singapore is so small, we don't have much space, so we have a small test track. It's used all the time by many different companies, from 95 all day. So, but we also have a digital twin. So we have a version, a software, of the same test track, where we run simulations. Okay. So why simulations? Because we have a test track. Why would you care about having simulations? Of course, the challenge of the AV systems are very complex. You have different sensors, you have AV, so you have AI algorithms, and so the whole system is quite complex. Also the environment, the road conditions that support traffic conditions is quite complex. Very hard to test all possible situations in the physical or physical track. So it's meaningful to run tests and simulations. It's much less expensive and also safer. Yeah. Okay, so here is, as I said before, the digital version of our test track. And so, as I mentioned before, as also seen in the first part, sensors are not perfect. You have all kinds of noise in the sensors. Cameras, of course, suffer from or have issues when it's dark, when it's foggy, when it's raining. Radar sensors have issues when you have metallic objects around the car, metallic guards, for instance. And then LiDAR also has issues when it's very bright. You can have noise when it's raining, you have noise as well. So we have to deal with noise in the sensors. And so far, most researchers have modeled noise in the sensor level. We don't care about the sensors per se, we care about perception. We care about what the car actually sees. Does it see all the pedestrians, the lanes properly, other cars, trucks? That's the level where we want to model errors. So we model errors on the perception level, that means on the level of the object list. We check which objects has the car detected, which ones it hasn't detected. So it's on the level of perception, not on the level of sensors. So if you take an off-the-shelf AV simulator, it assumes perfect sensors and perfect perception. There's no physical modeling. If you take any existing simulator, you will find that it's assuming a perfect perception system. Of course, in real life, it's never perfect. So what we do is we build perception error models and inject those into the existing AV simulators. So we're able to simulate the EVs in a more realistic manner by adding perception errors. Telling that, we can then look at the effect of perception errors on the behavior. Okay. So if the car, for instance, has a mistake in the bounding box, maybe the bounding box is too small, it may think that the object is far away, or vice versa. If the bounding box is way too big, it may think that the object is close than actually it is. So we model errors in the object detected objects, and I'll show you examples of that. Okay. So we had two projects. First, we did something simple. We had a simple project to start with. We modeled errors in the received object info, specifically the position and the dimensions of the bounding boxes derived from cameras. And the second phase, which is now ongoing, we're looking at a more holistic approach where we look at different types of sensors. And you're modeling different types of errors. Not just position and dimension, also other aspects like a label, mistaken labels and so forth. Okay. So how about the bounding box? Ideally, we'd like to have the bounding box nicely around the pedestrians, nicely around the cars and so forth. nice fit. Looks great. That's what you want. In practice, however, maybe like this. Maybe it's bigger, too big, maybe wrong location and so forth. So that's the real scenario technique. And so, if it's just too small, say it's actually half the size, you may think that the pedestrian is far away. You may actually crash into the pedestrian, of course. So the size here matters, of course. Yeah? And so what we did is we took public data, which had been labeled. So we have the manually labeled bounding boxes. And we run also a detector. So we have the manually labeled bounding boxes. We have the output of the detector. And we compute the error in the left and XY corners of the left top corner and bottom right corner. So we have four error signals. So we have the error in top left, bottom right, and X and Y. So we have such empirical data. We have the error in the time, and then we learn stochastic models in here to basically fit those errors. Once we have those models, we can simulate from them. So we simulate errors based on data. And we can inject those errors in the simulation output. That's how we make the simulation more realistic. We actually shuffle, remove the bounding box to make it more realistic, more as if it's from a real TV. Sorry, these blue curves are empirical curves showing the error, the offset between the ground truth labeled by a human and the output of a detector. We have it, we have four curves, like X and Y top left, X and Y bottom right. Then we fit linear and nonlinear models to those curves, and then once we have those models, we can actually simulate from them and simulate errors in the bounding box. We use that to run simulations. Okay. The second approach we do the following, so it's not based on learning, we actually set the errors ourselves. So in this case, what we have is the following. We have here the ADAS system, the virtual system, and the autonomous driving system, and we bypass the real actual sensors and perception system by the perception error model. So the output of that is the object list, but it's a noisy object list. So we may take out certain objects, we may add like phantom objects, we may perturb the labels, we may shift some objects, so we get a noisy object list in the simulator. So we replace the actual system by perception error model, which outputs noisy objects. And then that's fed into the decision system of the AE. That will behave in a particular way, depending on how much noise there is in the objects. And how do we define the errors? Well, we define it based on zones. So if you look at here, in this case, you have a camera, you can define this zone and then that zone, you have different levels of error in each zone. That's a LiDAR system here. If you combine them, naturally you have actually three zones. You have a zone where both are active, both LiDAR and the camera. And then you have two additional zones as here. So you have naturally three different zones with three different levels of error. So that's how we define different error levels. So with experiments, in the first project we used the car maker. Simulate the environment of the vehicle, also the vehicle itself, an auto-layer that implements the decision making in the vehicle. And in the second phase, ongoing project, we used a more recent LGSVL simulator. Maybe some of you know about that. It was released some only a few months ago, very powerful. And also Apollo, developed by Baidu, which is powerful auto-layer. Okay, so here's how it kind of looks like. So as I said, we perturb the bounding boxes, so it's now noisy, as you can see, in simulations, and that the noise on the bounding boxes actually comes from a stochastic model which we trained on real data. Right? So we did that. So we give this bounding box to the, in this case, auto-wear system, and the system, the car will behave in a certain way depending on how the bounding box is positioned. Okay. cloud behaves, how it breaks, and so forth. So to illustrate this, you have multiple trials. So one case is without error, and four cases with error. You can see that the trajectory is different each time, of course, and if you look at the break profile, it's also different each time. So you can run many simulations and check. But this is between the car, the ego vehicle, and the pedestrian. And you can build a risk map for that particular vehicle. Okay. That's how we started doing the risk analysis. So we add random errors to the landing boxes. It's a simple approach to do. Look at the behavior of the car, maybe in an errorless way. And now look into more complex environments, like one pedestrian, or maybe more pedestrians, other road users, and so forth. Okay, so in the second phase, we looked into Apollo, as you can see over here, and also LG and SVL simulator. And we replace the perception model of Apollo. Basically, we replace it by our perception error model. So instead of feeding raw data into Apollo, into its perception system, we bypass the raw data and the perception model, the perception system, excuse me, we replace it by the perception error model. So the output is the noisy list of objects which go into the decision-making system of the in that world. So how does it look like? We look at a few scenarios. One is, for instance, a car following a traffic vehicle over here, and case of jaywalking, different scenario. And then you can create test cases where you look at different speeds, for instance, or different scenarios where you have pedestrians standing at the side or in the middle of the road or jaywalking. So the test case is a combination of the scenario and also the different parameters. So for each test case, we run many different simulations. So here's how it looks like. This is a case without any noise, any perception, without perception error. So you have jaywalking here, you have a pedestrian, and you have a perfect bounding box. The car perfectly receives the jaywalker. And this is now with noise. You can see that the bounding box is noisy, it's moving around. Sometimes it's not there, it doesn't appear in the screen. Okay. So that's a noisy version. And then Apollo will decide, will plan a path in the noisy bounding box. This is also a noisy case, tracking the vehicle, so sometimes it's not detected, sometimes it is, and the bounding box can also randomly move around. So it looks like, I don't know if you have built perception systems yourself, I've done this myself, and it's more or less like a real system. And here we actually show the bounding boxes in the environment. You can see that the bounding boxes are not perfect. They are sometimes missing. Also, the location is not always perfect. Okay. So, you can imagine doing this for many different scenarios, creating risk maps in a systematic manner for AVs, using regions. So, here's the thing. So, let's assume that the detection rate of the detector is 50%. The detection rate of the detector is 50%. And let's look at two different scenarios. In one case, so say you have maybe 1 minute of data, different frames. In the first case, it does not detect the first half of the frames. Sorry, it doesn't detect the pedestrian in the first half of the frames. In the second half, it does detect the pedestrian every single time. Okay? So first, it doesn't see the pedestrian. And after some time, it does detect the pedestrian and follows it and finds all the time. Second case, detects the pedestrian, does detect. And so on and so forth. So it's intermittent. So what is, you think, the most damaging, the most impactful for the EV? Just look at that case. They have the same detection rate. On average, half the frames have missed detections. So what is the most impactful? First case, of course. Because at the beginning, it doesn't even see the pedestrian at all. So what's the point here? Detection rate may not be the best metric. It's often used in computer vision, correct? But if you put the perception system in the top, you should check, we should use metrics which really quantify the risk of the EV. So here's just one curve, a few curves to illustrate, a few graphs to illustrate the results. So we show here certain risk measures, the minimum spatial clearance, the minimum temporal distance, which are kind of risk measures, as a function of the frequency of detection rates, and the non-detection, the longest interval of non-detection, longest interval of non-detection. Okay. So even if the detection rate is only 50%, you can still, in some cases, perform really well. You have still large clearance, much clearance. As I said, if you have this case, sorry, the second case, it's fine, right? Okay, you don't detect the pedestrian every second frame, but still you can, you know, you can apply a common filter, a particle filter, you can fill in the gaps, it's going to be okay. So even though we have a low average detection rate, you still have much clearance, it's fine. However, if you look at the longest interval of non-detection, and that's large, most likely you will not have a large clearance. Okay. That's the first case. Here we have a long interval of non-detection. Okay. That means most likely you have high risk of crashing, you have low clearance and time, and speed and time. So that's just to illustrate that it's important to look into the right metrics, supervision metrics, when you want to quantify risk of autonomous vehicles. It's something we're now learning and exploring. So in summary, the first part, I talked about perception systems, specifically based on vision. The point is that they're not perfect, and people are trying to make them more and more robust. But they will never be perfect, of course. There will always be errors. And that's why it's important to simulate EVs with non-ideal perception systems, which is still ongoing work. Research groups are trying to do this. And so we've shown that it's important to look at the right metrics and detection metrics when you design autonomous vehicles. So we'd like to thank my team, and also, of course, the sponsors, which I have off here. That's it. Sponsors. Thank you.
Maybe some intuition about why your approach seems to work better than adversarial perturbations, which roughly, I mean adversarial, not sorry, than standard augmentation techniques, which seem to, it would seem to do the same thing, but perform much worse.
I think you're referring to this bar graph.
You may have gotten this.
This one, right?
Yeah.
You're asking about these graphs versus...
Well, yeah, Adiscan is so much better than rotation augmentation, but what it seems like you're doing is encoding rotation augmentations into the generation process.
Yes.
So what I'm curious about is, do you have any intuition for why Adiscan is so much better?
Because it actually prefers the angle, whereas if you... you mean compared to adding rotations?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, if you add rotations, it doesn't learn the angle. It doesn't care about the angle. It just tells you that this is a particular object is cats. So every time you see the cats, it will just tell you it's cats. It doesn't tell you anything about the saturation itself. It doesn't learn anything about how the image has been transformed. Maybe that's the reason why. So now, since we want to design the serial attacks, you have to overcome the rotations, the physical transformations as well. Probably have to design attacks which are invariant under affine transformations. I think that's the issue.
Thank you.
Because if you,
I'm gonna say, I don't know the answer to your question. It's still in research. So if you look at the noise vector, I think
if you look at it from different angles, it would not be effective. If you rotate this image, right, this noise vector, it would not allow me an attack. In fact, it has stayed in this angle. That's not for scaling probably, and it's skewed. Yes?
Yeah. Also, like about Adiscan, and to clarify a little bit, because I don't know if I understood it well. So the idea behind the model is to let the model know the transformations that have been done to the data, and
yeah.
That helps it learn more robustly.
Yes.
let me try to explain this. So this is standard GAN.
Yeah.
What we do is actually we take a data info GAN. So we have eight variables in the system, which encode the digit 0, 1, up to 9. It's actually, we look into, so we start with bidirectional, it's a bidirectional info GAN. It's going to be to see the image itself, also the noise factor, and the latent factor. Okay? So that's our starting points, and then we add to this the transformations. Okay? So the transformations are on this path, on the path of the real images. So we transform, we generate the transformation matrix, a high transformation matrix. We transform the images, the real ones, and then the encoder basically learns the transformation, the first transformation. So the encoder separates the latent variable from the transformations. So that's a disentanglement. The content about semantics, if you will, is separated from the physical variations.
Okay, so that the system is trained
to detect the digit,
zero,
one, up to nine, and also figure out the angle, the scaling, the speed, and so on. That's all done on the encoder thermostat. It's not in this path, it's not the path.
Okay.
The take images.
And another question would be, is this approach, why does this approach make sense in a GAN type of architecture and not in a just like a classifier only system?
I think it also does make sense.
Yeah, okay.
It doesn't have to be GAN. My students wanted to play with GANs, so it takes time, but I think it also makes sense in the context, it doesn't have to be GAN.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes?
What parts of this sort of architecture are specific to, say, like autonomous vehicles versus, like, say, seeing someone walking down and trying to identify the attributes of like the dress that they're wearing, like the length, the neckline, stuff like that, like in a retail sense. So
of course, it's more generic than just autonomous vehicles. I mean, it was just a motivation and illustration of this approach.
But like, is there anything in the architecture that's specific only to autonomous vehicles, or is the entire thing easily generalized?
There's a catch. It only works well for MIST. Dataset, because in this dataset you have a very simple universe of only 9 different digits, no background, angles make sense. If you have a sphere, the meaning of angle is not really defined. So it makes sense to talk about angles in the context of the digits. So it works well for the NIST dataset. We have tried other datasets, like ImageNet, and it doesn't work well. So we try to improve the system, make it more generalizable to other datasets. So that's a catch at this moment. We try to improve it, to be honest with you. You have a question?
Oh, I think I forgot what it is. I remembered what it is. So with the augmentation, my impression is that you just rotated
the
images and so on.
The cut image, yes. The example. You just rotate and scale and translate. That's a typical approach. You augment the data with different variations.
But you could also, I could imagine an augmentation where you're actually including the label that the angle, for example. So it learns from the images not just that it's a cat, but it's a cat rotated at X degrees. And I was just wondering if
yes, it could be done, and I actually labeled it, and the system here infers it from the image itself.
I know that's what you do, but I'm just
yes.
asking about the sort of
could be done, yes. But you would still be augmenting your data set.
Mm-hmm.
You're not augmenting the data set. So it's, yeah. So what's the, yeah. It could learn the angle by itself. So it's then a regression problem. So it takes the label, plus it infers the angle, but it's done by regression. Because you've given many examples of rotated images and the angles, it determines this mapping. But it's not, it doesn't have the physical transformation itself embedded in the system. Right? So we tell it it's a fine transformation. It just has to learn the angles, different parameters.
Okay.
quick question. Just your opinion on the whole debate between single sensor or multiple sensor sets, and especially in the context of the robust perception issues you did for both your personal opinion and what's the consensus right now amongst the ADAS people?
There's no consensus, I think. Okay. Some people, some companies, I won't mention names, and neighbors here, right? They do not like to use LiDAR because it's too expensive. So, of course, if you think about the economic aspects, this is often you don't want to have LiDAR. It's just too expensive, the more expensive the whole car itself. But, yeah, this is, if you see my first part of my talk, the thing is, we have a good idea to rely only on cameras. Think of Singapore, when it rains, it rains very hard, that's a lot.
I grew up in the area, so.
Right, so the car is even human driving to stop at yeah. So in such environments, I think that camera only will not make sense. So at this stage, we still have to combine camera and LiDAR, multiple LiDARs sometimes, and radars.
Yeah.
But LiDAR will become less expensive, becoming much more compact, and also less expensive. It's a matter of time before it becomes affordable.
Yeah, that's what it's good. You're born Phoenix and Singapore have all different environment, graduate environments.
Does Phoenix have dust, fog, rain, snow, and media? So it's still a question of combining multiple sensors. Even then, it's not enough. So it's a really hard problem to see through rain. You could even combine LiDAR, radar.
So maybe that there's no universal solution. It's more geographic and segment specific.
I guess so at this stage. Yeah. Singapore, we don't have snow, so the local developers don't care about snow. For sure. Because in California, people don't care about snow. Yes.
I'm
not
familiar with your sample yourself, but what can you explain why so sometimes when you face this problem, deep learning, we will use the CNN to fix that image orientation.
Yeah, so CNN fails when the images are rotated because it has only been trained on images which are straight, so that's small.
But the conclusion that neural network can fix that
image orientation. I guess if you incorporate rotations as a transformation. Maybe if you add more neurons, you can make it invariant to rotations. I guess so.
Oh, we want to thank you very much as a sign of our appreciation for your visit. One more hand for Dr. Dauwels.